So imagine that you have a bunch of bombs, for whatever reason. And these bombs are photon sensitive or light sensitive, which means that if you shine a light or even a single photon at one of them, they will detonate and explode. But the problem is that some of these bombs are duds. Is there a way to test whether a bomb is live without detonating it? Quantum physics says there is. These two guys with really cool names, Avshalom Elitza and Lev Vaidman, came up with a thought experiment to solve this problem using what they called an interaction-free measurement, meaning that they could test whether a bomb was live without an explosion. To understand this, we need to talk a little bit about something called quantum superposition. Quantum superposition is a theory that an object exists in all possible states at the same time, and the act of measuring that object forces it to choose one state. So there's a very famous thought experiment about this called Schrodinger's Cat. In a box, there is a cat, a vial of poison, a hammer, a Geiger counter, and some radioactive material. When the radioactive material decays, the Geiger counter detects it, triggers the hammer to smash the vial, and kills the cat. The thing is, we don't know when the radioactive material will decay. It's completely random. So if we were to guess at any moment in time, would the cat be alive or dead? Surely it must be one or the other, right? Well, according to quantum physics, the cat exists in a superposition of being both alive and dead. Remember, it exists in all possible states until it is measured or observed. It is only when we open the box and take a look that the cat has to choose a state. Today, it chooses to be alive. Okay, so a cat can't exist in a state of quantum superposition because it's not a quantum object. But let's take a look at another experiment, which uses something called a Mach-Zehnder interferometer. A Mach-Zehnder interferometer consists of a light source, a beam splitter, two mirrors, another beam splitter, and two light detectors. The light source emits a beam of light and the beam splitter splits the beam exactly 50-50. The mirrors guide the light toward the second beam splitter, where the two beams recombine and interfere. Now the setup is configured so that the beams constructively interfere on detector A and destructively interfere on detector B. I have an entire video which goes more into constructive and destructive interference called the double slit experiment, which I've linked in the description below, but all you really need to know here is that when the beams interfere at the second beam splitter, all of the light will show up on detector A. Detector B is left completely dark. So because of the way the setup is configured, 100% of the light shows up on detector A. Cool. But what would happen if we slowed the light beam down? Slowed it down so much that it only emitted a single photon at a time. This is where things get a bit weird. Classically, we would expect that 50% of the time the photon showed up on detector A, and 50% of the time it showed up on detector B. I mean, I know we said that the light beams interfere constructively on A, but you need two objects to interfere with each other. So in the case of a single photon, it should show up on both detectors. But the results showed that 100% of the time the photon showed up on detector A, not a single photon was detected on B. So what's going on? The photon interferes with itself? Yeah! So the photon takes both parts and interferes with itself at the second beam splitter. Now I know what you're thinking. Aren't the detectors a form of measurement? Well, notice the detectors only really measure what happens to the photon after it hits the second beam splitter. If the photon takes the lower path, there is a 50-50 chance it will end up on either detector A or B. And if the photon takes the upper path, there is still a 50-50 chance it will end up on detector A or B. So the detectors actually tell us nothing about which path the photon took. This not knowing is what allows the photon to undergo quantum superposition, existing in both possible states and taking both paths. I know it sounds crazy, but this happens. So how can we use this weird phenomena to test bombs? Well, let's first place a dud bomb in the lower path. Now let's see what happens if the photon takes the upper path. A 50-50 chance it shows up on A or B. Okay, nothing unexpected there. Now what if the photon takes the lower path? There is still a 50-50 chance it shows up on A or B. From the perspective of the photon, nothing has changed. It doesn't interact with the bomb in any way. So the detectors still tell us nothing about which path the photon took, meaning that it still meets the requirements for quantum superposition. The photon takes both paths, interferes with itself, and shows up on detector A. So if the bomb is a dud, the photon will always 100% of the time show up on detector A. Now let's try the live bomb. Now this is the game changer. We place a live bomb in the lower path, and the photon happens to also take the lower path. The photon sensor is working, the bomb absorbs the photon and explodes, so no photon shows up on either detector. Now if the photon takes the upper path, it will either show up on detector A or B. Wait, so the detectors do tell us something here. If no photon is detected, it took the lower path. If the photon shows up on either detector, it took the upper path. Because the detectors tell us which path the photon took, it no longer meets the requirements for quantum superposition and is forced to choose a path. So when the bomb is live, 50% of the time the photon is absorbed and not detected. 25% of the time the photon shows up on detector A, and 25% of the time it shows up on detector B. Now this last 25% is the real significance of this experiment. So when no photon is detected, the bomb is live. When a photon is detected on A, it could be either live or a dud, and the experiment needs to be repeated. But when a photon is detected on B, the bomb is live, and we were able to detect this without an explosion. Okay, so there were a few explosions. I mean, a 25% success rate isn't the best in the world. But the idea of a quantum bomb tester is still pretty cool. What did you think about this thought experiment? I would love to hear your thoughts in the comments below. If you liked this video, give it a thumbs up, and don't forget to subscribe if you want to see more videos like this one. Here's actually another one I thought you might like, so check that out if you like. And yeah, I'll see you next time. Bye!